Well, many more Australians are living with serious depression, and the use of antidepressants has doubled in the past 20 years. But could we be looking for solutions in the wrong places? Well, journalist and author Johann Hari has raised a lot of questions and searched for answers right across the world. Johann, welcome back to Studio 10.
I'm so happy to be back with you guys.
Nice seeing you. Yeah. In fact, you've written a whole book on this stuff. Let's go back to the beginning and your own experiences of depression. When did you know you had a problem and what did you do initially to treat it?
Yeah, when I was a teenager, I went to my doctor and I remember going in and saying to him that I had this feeling like pain was leaking out of me and I couldn't control it, I couldn't regulate it. I felt quite ashamed of it and I was just looking for just something that would get me through, really. I remember the story my doctor told me, which I believed for many years, and I now know was oversimplified. There's some truth in it, but so simplified. He said, well, we know why people feel this way. Some people just naturally have a chemical imbalance in their brains. You're clearly one of them. All we need to do is drug you, you're gonna be all right. And so I started taking a drug called Ceroxat. And I did feel a lot better initially. Effect kind of wore off. I started taking a higher and higher dose until for 13 years I was taking the maximum possible dose, at the end of which I was still depressed. So when I started doing the research for Lost Connections, my book about this, I was just kind of, there was this mystery really hanging over me, which is that, as you say, you know, I'm nearly 40. Every year that I've been alive, depression and anxiety have increased across the Western world.
Yeah.
I was thinking, well, why is this happening? What's going on here? Because if it was just a problem in our brains, why would it be rising so much? And so that's really the kind of journey. I went and met the leading scientists in the world. Lots of people who've been through this, recovered, lots of different people all over the world to really try to find answers to that.
And so was it when you were a teenager that you became dependent on antidepressants, would you say? Or how did that happen? And then more importantly, how did you get control back?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it was about dependency. The drugs give some relief to some people, but...
Would you say you became addicted?
No, I wouldn't say I became addicted to them. I took them. And they were giving me a bit of help initially, and that was the only thing I was being told was the solution to my problem. So, of course, I thought, well, if it's wearing off, I'll take more and more. So this is one of the things that was really important to me in doing the research for Lost Connections, which was trying to figure out, well, what's the solution for all the people who are only getting a little bit of help from chemical antidepressants? The research shows, over time, most people taking chemical antidepressants become depressed again, which doesn't mean they're not getting some relief from it. They are.
So if it wasn't a chemical imbalance in your brain that was causing you to be depressed, did you find out what it actually was? Because you need to treat the cause, really.
Exactly. I think you put it so well. The scientific evidence I learned from the leading experts in the world of 9 causes of depression and anxiety. And I think...
Is it hereditary?
There's a genetic component. Right, so your genes make you more vulnerable to these things, but they never write your destiny, right? So we all know this about eating, right? Some people can eat 10 Big Macs, never put on any weight. I only have to eat one mouthful and my chin starts as well, right? So we know some people function, but equally, if I don't eat any Big Macs, you know, if I eat healthily, I'm not going to gain a load of weight. Depression's a bit like that. So your genes can make you more vulnerable, but they never write your destiny. No one is determined by their genes to become depressed. It's a different way of thinking about it. There's the 9 causes that I look at. Some of them, not all, you're right to raise genes, which are one of them. A lot of them are connected by something different, which is everyone watching your show knows they've got natural physical needs, right? Obviously, you need food, you need water, you need clean air, you need shelter. If I took them away from any of you, you'd be obviously in trouble really quickly. There's equally strong evidence that human beings have natural psychological needs. You need to feel you belong. You need to feel your life has meaning and purpose. You need to feel that people see you and value you. You need to feel you've got a future that makes sense. And our culture's good at lots of things. I'm glad to be alive today. But we've been getting less and less good at meeting these deep underlying psychological needs.
Even as you listed those things, I felt myself spiralling down. Because it is that they're the things that people so often lack in our modern world.
I think that's really moving. And I'll give you a good example. It's been an explosion in loneliness across the Western world.
Yeah.
It's a study in the United States that asks, how many close friends do you have who you could turn to in a crisis? When they started doing it years ago, the most common answer was 5. Today, the most common answer is none, right?
Yeah, because of smartphones and because of all that technology that people are buried in there these days.
And we're not doing this. People are working 7 days a week. Yeah, the 9 to 5 doesn't exist anymore. People are working overtime just to put food on.
But you're not saying in this whole scheme of your way of thinking and your approach is to not take antidepressants. There's a place for them.
Yeah, chemical antidepressants give some relief to some people, including some of my relatives, and they did to me initially. But you've got to be honest, though, we've been jacking that up for you know, 30 years and it's giving some relief, but it's not solving the problem. Mm. So what I was very much keen to figure out, going all over the world, was, well, where has actually reduced this problem? What strategies can we do? So let's think about loneliness, the one that we were just talking about. One of the heroes of my book, Lost Connections, is an amazing doctor in East London called Sam Everington, who had loads of patients coming to him with terrible depression and anxiety. And like me, like you, he's not opposed to chemical antidepressants. He thinks they have some role.
Yeah.
But you could just see that they were depressed for perfectly understandable reasons, right? That their pain made sense is the main thing that I want to explain to people with depression and anxiety. If you're depressed, if you're anxious, you're not crazy, you're not a machine with broken parts, you're a human being with unmet needs. And Dr. Everington was like, well, how can I build on this? He decided to try a different approach. A woman came to him one day called Lisa Cunningham, who'd been shut away in her home with terrible depression for 7 years. I got to know her quite well. Sam said to Lisa, don't worry, I'll carry on giving these drugs. I'm also going to prescribe something else. There was an area behind the doctor's surgery that was like scrubland, basically. He said, what I want you to do is come and turn up a couple of times a week. I'm going to turn out and support you. And with a group of other depressed and anxious people, we're going to make a beautiful garden. Mm. They started to get their fingers in the soil. They started to learn the rhythms of the seasons. And they started to get to know each other as a group and care about each other. They started to notice when they weren't there. The way Lisa put it to me, as the garden began to bloom, we began to bloom. And there was a study in Norway of a very similar program, found it was more than twice as effective as chemical antidepressants. And this is something I saw all over the world and that I write about in much more detail in the book. The most effective strategies for dealing with depression and anxiety are the ones that deal with the reasons why we're so depressed and anxious in the first place.
You know what surprised me is that we're the second biggest taker of antidepressants in the world, apart from Iceland.
And one of them's Bjork, so they're all...
I think it's really, really important, though, to stress to everyone at home that your book is certainly not advocating for people to stop using antidepressants at all or suddenly, because that can be extremely, extremely
dangerous. Oh, you can have horrific withdrawal
symptoms.
That's right. 20% of people who stop taking these drugs experience dreadful withdrawal symptoms, and even more people who take them experience ongoing withdrawal, ongoing symptoms. So, no, people shouldn't start taking them casually, people shouldn't stop taking them casually.
But what I love about the book is that it offers a holistic approach to the way we treat depression, and I think although antidepressants can be, you know, a wonderful, wonderful way to kind of give your mind a bit of a break, there are other therapies you need to use in conjunction.
I think you're totally right. And to me, it's a beautiful way of putting it. And I think to me, the issue is more the story that we're telling, right? If I think about that story my doctor told me, it's just a problem in your brain. What that does is it cuts us off from finding the causes of depression and anxiety in our lives and dealing with them. So in my case, for example, it's a hard thing to talk about, but I go through in the book the evidence that if you've experienced a severely traumatic childhood, you are radically more likely to become depressed and anxious as an adult. And actually, you are significantly more likely to attempt suicide. And I had experienced from an adult in my life some very extreme acts. And I, you know, it makes me think about how unethical it is that my doctor, who was a decent person who just didn't know this stuff, I think, that my doctor the 13 years I was being prescribed antidepressants.
So he knew your history,
your
background?
No, this is the thing, that in all those 13 years, no doctor ever said to me, is there any reason you might feel this way? You know, and I'm not critical of doctors, they've got 5 minutes to see people, you know, but we've got to have as a culture a much deeper response, not least because there's this incredible evidence that I found incredibly helpful from a wonderful man called Dr. Vincent Felitti, who's in California, that shows if you get people, it's not actually childhood trauma that causes these problems. It's shame about childhood trauma.
Yeah.
If you give people safe places where they pioneered this program where doctors talked to people about their childhood trauma and just said to them, just for 5 minutes, just said, I'm really sorry that happened to you. That should never have happened, and apologize to them. Just that one act of having an authority figure say, I'm so sorry this happened, that alone led to a really significant fall in depression and anxiety. And to me, I think what we need to do, to me, that is an antidepressant, right?
Yeah.
That anything that reduces depression should be regarded as an antidepressant.
Mm.
That is partly chemicals, but we need to think about antidepressants in a much broader way. That gardening program is an antidepressant. I go through a huge range of them. It's the last third of the book. We need to think in a much deeper and more compassionate way about this problem.
Johann Hari's book is called Lost Connections. It is a really interesting read. Check it out, Johann. Lovely to see you again.
Totally lovely to be with you all.
Thanks.